Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Hello, everyone, and welcome back for those of you who have been with us for the workshop. This is the last event for the week. And also welcome to those of you who join us on the YouTube live stream today. So I want to remind everybody that exceptionally or differently from the rest of the week, today's session is being live streamed on YouTube because it is the closing session of the workshop, but also because we've incorporated this event today as part of a series of events in the series of the International Year of Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development, more about which in a minute from Marco. As we have tried to do throughout the week, we are trying to bring a variety of perspectives to bear on the problem of ethical challenges in machine learning. We've heard from a number of scholars working cross-disciplinarily throughout the week. And we're very pleased today to have four panelists and speakers with us today that will illustrate their own perspectives on the problems. I'll introduce them in a minute, and then we'll close off the workshop and close off the event with a panel discussion around 3 o'clock. And again, very, very happy to have seen so much engagement, so much participation throughout the week, and I'm sure it will be the same today. Marco, if you want to say a few words about the International Year of Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development, perhaps, before we kick off.
Yes, thank you, Roberto. I even have some slides that I will show. So, as Roberto said, today's session will be also presented in the framework of the International Year of Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development, and the title of this seminar is Embedding Ethics in Machine Learning. So what is this year about? So this year is about focusing on the links between basic sciences and the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. And the idea is that this is a unique opportunity to discuss with stakeholders, with government, with institutions, and convince them that a basic understanding of nature is really important so that action will be more effective for the common goal. And ICTP and UNESCO are partners of this international year. One slide about the SDGs. We mentioned that during this week a couple of times. I'm sure you heard about it, but the SDGs have been developed in the framework of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, which was adopted by all UN member states in 2015, as they share a blueprint for peace and prosperity for people and the planet now and in the future. And in the framework of this agenda, they've developed 17 sustainable development goals, which are a call for all the countries developed and developing for a global partnership. And I think the main point about SDGs is that in some way they have to be reached all together. So they go hand by hand. So the idea is that if you improve, you know, education, that will also benefit health, it will benefit economic growth, and so on. And at the same time, we want to tackle climate change and work to preserve oceans and forests. So these different aspects go together. In a graphical way, you can see them here. And as was mentioned yesterday and the day before yesterday, AI can play a role to reach some of these or to tackle some of these SDGs. We heard about health, we heard about education, we heard about decent work and economic growth and so on. So this is the SDGs. What about basic sciences? Well, it was highlighted that basic sciences are the sine qua non for sustainable development. And in fact, they're essential means to meet crucial challenges, such as, you know, access to food, to health coverage, and to communication technologies. And in fact, to tackle the issues of, you know, 8 billion people on the planet, and to, you know, reach this climate change and depletion of natural resources and so on, basic sciences are really, really important. And in fact, applications of technologies are quite easy to recognize. In fact, we sometimes have the risk of focusing only on that. But on the other hand, contribution of basic sciences are not really appreciated, but at the same time, they're really, really important. Just to name one, we're using the web, and that was developed at CERN as part of a basic science research in some way. So again, this international year is to highlight the importance of basic sciences for the SDGs. And ICTP has planned a number of activities to support these teams. So this seminar is a part of these activities, but we have more of them. This year was inaugurated just a couple of months ago at the UNESCO headquarters in Paris, and events will be organized around the world up to June next year. And in fact, ICTP itself will organize more activities about climate change, AI, human ecology, and open science. Finally, the website, you can find it here on the top of the page, and you're very much welcome to visit it so you can see what other events are going on all over the world. And that's all from my side. Back to you, Roberto.
Thank you, Marco. That's really interesting and really a perfect fit for all, many of the things we've been discussing this week. So today, I'm very pleased to welcome our panelists, the first of whom is Dr. Jabera Matogoro. I think Jabera is here. Are you?
Is it? Yes, I'm here. Thank you.
Yeah. Hello. Welcome. Let me introduce Dr. Matogoro, who has a PhD in telecommunications engineering and a master's in science in computer science from the University of Dodoma in Tanzania. He's a teaching staff at the Department of Computer Science and Engineering of the College of Informatics and Virtual Education and project team member of Artificial Intelligence for Development. He's working to establish Africa's Anglophone Multidisciplinary Research Lab, and he's the founder and chief executive officer for Tanzania Community Networks Alliance, which is an umbrella organization for community networks in Tanzania, or Tanzania. I'm not entirely sure how you pronounce it in English. Maybe Tanzania, please correct me. Dr. Matogoro is the recipient of the Open Internet Engineering Mozilla Fellowship for 2019 and 2020. And we are delighted to have him here with us today to talk about the experience from Anglophone Africa on ethical and societal challenges of machine learning. Please, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Robert. And I also shared you a deck of slides. I'm not sure if you can.
Yes, I was going to. I was going to display them now. Just a second, just to share my screen. Absolutely. Hopefully, you can see it. Please just say next slide when you want the next slide displayed. If I can find a way to make it full screen. Oops.
No, it's not.
Can you see it?
It's not the one.
It's because when I go full screen, it's not there. So just a second. When I share it, it goes in the wrong screen. Sorry.
Yeah, I see that.
That's what's happening. I'm gonna go back to Zoom if I may. Apologies, this was not what it was supposed to be doing. Okay, let me try again. Maybe I'll try the PDF because the I got a problem with the I think the PowerPoint gives me a problem. Okay, let me try with this. Share the screen again.
Mine was in PDF. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I got a PDF here as well. Is that okay? Can you see this?
I shared the PDF, I think.
Oh, can you see my screen now? Marco, can you see my screen?
Yes, but it's Monday's presentation, I think.
I'm so sorry. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry. I got the wrong PDF. You're right.
It happened, actually.
I got it here. It was in the same deck and the same email conversation. That's why I got it lost. Okay. Okay. Little hiccup. Here we are.
Yes.
Okay, can I go perfect. Full screen?
I can try too. Full screen. Can you see this now?
Perfect.
Please go ahead. Perfect. I'm sorry. So sorry.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, as Robert mentioned, I'm part of the research team on AI for the Africa's Anglophone Multidisciplinary Research Lab. And we are working to see how the artificial intelligence can help to address challenges facing humanity. And I'm happy to share experience on ethical and societal challenges of the machine learning and how we are trying to embed those issues in our research lab. Next slide. Yes, we actually made the official launch this year in January, and as part of the launching, we had the government of Tanzania, that's the deputy permanent secretary from the Minister of Information, Communication and Information Technology. And we are happy that the government is supporting and we are working on behalf of the Anglophone Africa. Next slide, thank you. And these are also some of the university management, the vice chancellor, the deputy vice chancellor, research, academic, and consultants. And we also have the deputy vice chancellor for the planning, finance, and the administration. Next slide, thank you. Yes, maybe I need to spend some few times on the challenges. Why are we working on the lab? We are trying to address almost four critical challenges. One is the skills. We understand the artificial intelligence existed since 1946 when it was first mentioned. But the uptake, especially in addressing the social challenges, has been limited. Particularly in the academic context. So we understand some of the challenges, especially in the Anglophone Africa, is the shortage of human capacity. And the lab is working towards addressing the shortage of human capacity, where we are training youth, women, and people in the Anglophone Africa to be able to participate actively in the AI industry. The next challenge we are trying to address is on the infrastructure. We understand that there is a raw uptake of artificial intelligence, especially in the Anglophone Africa, because of the lack of high computing power, especially that can compute and manipulate larger data sets. And also there is also challenges on the African origin data set. You find in the academic context, people are learning about artificial intelligence, but when the training model and algorithms, they are actually using data which are not from the African regions. So as part of the lab, we are also working to address that issues. And the third challenge we are also trying to address as part of the lab is on the inclusion. We understand in the current situation, there is a poor inclusion of gender and marginalized group, especially in the Anglophone Africa. So as part of the activities of the lab, we also trying to come up with a solution that will contribute to addressing the inclusion, especially in artificial intelligence and machine learning. And the other challenge, as I also mentioned when I was speaking about infrastructure, is on the data set. We understand that most of the data sets that are available, especially from Africa's, you may find they are not ready for the AI usage. That means may not be usable for training model and the algorithms. So as part of the lab, we are also working to contribute on a contraction or development of the African origin data set. I understand there are also other initiatives towards addressing this, but as a lab, we are also working toward having African origin data set that can help in addressing issues in the society in the Anglophone Africa. Next slide, please. Yes, I remember Marco was speaking about the sustainable development goals. And for our lab, we are working on a number of sustainable development goals, like goal number 9, industrial innovation and infrastructure. Also on goal number 2, zero hunger. And goal number 13, climate action. And also we are working on goal number 3, good health and the well-being. So from the point of what Dr. Marco was mentioning, so we find there are a number of synergies and we are looking forward working with ICTP and other stakeholders in this area. Next slide. Yes, so the lab is working on four thematic areas. The first one is infrastructure and the data ecosystem, where we are working towards supporting AI training, research, and innovation, but also contributing to the African origin data set. And the second thematic area where our team is working, or our lab is working, is on healthcare, which we are trying to apply AI for improving diagnosis in disease treatment and drug. Yes, thank you. And another area which we are working is on digital economy, where we are working to see how AI can accelerate digitization and automation of African industry. And also the fourth one is on environmental conservation and agriculture, where we are working to exploit the use of AI for environmental conservation and biodiversity monitoring. And also using AI for climate crisis management, where, as I mentioned, the AI for the Anglophone Research Lab is being executed by the University of Dodoma in collaboration with the Nelson Mandela African Institution of Science and Technology based in Arusha, both in Tanzania. Next slide. Yes, I think I should mention on what are we working on, how are we working toward a responsible AI? We understand that in order to have a responsible AI means we need to ensure inclusion. That means gender and marginalized group should be part of the equation. Also, we understand that data sharing and the protection policy is a critical part towards a responsible AI. And we are hoping that our research lab is also working toward contributing on the data sharing policies and protection in the Anglophone Africa. But the, another concept that we are also trying to bring on board is on the heels of a human-centered design approach, where we are taking on board stakeholders before developing AI machine learning solutions. Next slide, please. Yes, from principles to practice, in terms of technical, we are co-analysis and co-designing of AI systems. In terms of operations, we are trying to have a conducive environment that fosters AI uptakes in Anglophone Africa. And also in terms of organizations, then we are raising issues and concern with AI systems. So as part of our day-to-day activities, as the topic of this week, we have been discussing on the ethical issues as well as addressing such challenges. And this is what our lab is working towards, having a responsible AI in the Anglophone Africa. Next slide. Yes, we are also working, doing this in collaboration with some of our partners, CSIR in South Africa, Ifakara Health Institute in Tanzania, DLab, Research ICT Africa, Zindi, and we are excited to have many more partners joining us because we understand addressing the uptake of AI in Anglophone Africa, it's not a one-man show, and we would appreciate having more partners and stakeholders working on the same. Next slide. Thank you for listening, and I'm happy to be part of this conversation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jabera, for this very nice overview of all these efforts. I suggest we do, now go to Monday, who's also similarly going to give a short presentation and introduce him in a minute. And then we'll take questions on both your presentations and discussion at the end of this first part, if that's okay.
Yes.
Perfect. Let me first introduce our next speaker. Next speaker is Dr. Monde Adenomon, who is a senior lecturer in statistics in the Department of Statistics at Nasarawa State University in Nigeria. He's a trained statistician, and his research interests are in machine learning and in finance and economics and econometrics, time series analysis, financial time series analysis, spatial econometrics, and interdisciplinary statistical analysis. Monde is also the chair of the International Association of Statistical Computing, the ISSC Africa Members Group from 2021. He is a team leader of the Ambitious Africa Nigeria team from 2020, and is the lead organizer of the Northern Nigeria LISA 2020 Symposium. He's also the founder of the Foundation for the Laboratory for Econometrics and Applied Statistics of Nigeria. And he's going to talk to us about teaching machine learning with R in Nigeria, challenges and prospects. So very much focusing here on the educational aspect of machine learning. And I'm going to go and find your slides, Monde, in a second.
Okay.
Sorry about that. Got them here. I got the slides. Let me share the screen now. Here we go. Can you see my screen?
Yes, I can see the screen.
Perfect. Please, over to you.
Yeah. Well, once again, I really appreciate the organizer of this short course or workshop. Of the truth, I've enjoyed so many things, and we hope that what I've learned from this workshop will be passed across to my undergraduate student and postgraduate student. I will talk on the second slide what we are doing. Sorry, the next slide.
The outline slide. It's on. Yeah. Do you
well,
see it?
Yes. The outline slide will talk about what we do. We'll just look at introduction. We'll talk about the why open source, then why R, and then machine learning, then the challenges and prospects, then we'll now conclude. The next slide, we'll be talking about some of the things I do or we do. I also have team members. We have LISA. LISA means Laboratory for Interdisciplinary Statistical Analysis. It was a vision from one Professor Eric from USA. The essence of this network is to see how to build capacity of students, build capacity of researchers, how they can move between theory and practice, and also see how to influence decision-making in African countries using data. Using data science. For the African member group, AISC, it's called International Statistical Association Computing. The African member group, what we are doing that in that group also, want to see how we can also build capacity of researchers in Africa in respect to statistical computing. Then I'm also connected to R user group. Actually, IRUSA group have been doing great things in Nigeria, but they are supporting us in terms of funds to organize capacity building program, like workshop, like training. I'm the coordinator for the Nasarawa user group. For that of the family, it's a foundation that supports women and girls in data science. This foundation, recently, I'm collaborating with EBS in Cameroon. What they are trying to do, they want to see how they can ensure that education is attained by women and girls, and likewise the disadvantaged children. These are the things we do. Then, but for today, I'll be focusing on how we teach machine learning in our country here in Nigeria with respect to the northern part of the country. The next slide. Yeah, for us from experience in academics, we found that the field of data science is still young. And apart from that, we don't really have
a university or a polytechnic that run undergraduate program in data science. And apart from that also, we also found out that even the curriculum we have or we use, we are using, data science have not been integrated in the curriculum. In fact, sometimes, even in terms of the computing aspect, which is the statistical computing, is still lacking in our curriculum. But we use other foundation, other platform to see how we can easily, how we can also influence our students in using these codes and using R because of the advantage of using open source software. Now, the next slide, I'll be asking why open source software and why R? I know most of the participants here know the advantage of open source. In quote, you just talk about it's a free software, yes. And it's doing great things for us in Africa and developing countries like Nigeria. Because if you want to go for paid software, they can be very expensive. That takes me to the next slide. We will be working with some of this software. Like recently, I know that Minitab is trying to bring in machine learning into Minitab and some other software. But when we look at this software, they are great. They are doing great, but they are expensive. Because some of us, we use our personal facilities. Like me, like my university, we don't have a lab, a statistical lab. What we do, we use our, like me, I use my personal laptop. They will encourage our students if they can also get their personal laptop. And that could be, that is just a challenge, but we are breaking through since we have other options by having our own laptop and also having our own software. But for the for this software like EVU, they are expensive, $650. If you look at Stata is a great software too, but it's expensive. The next slide talks about SAS. For me, I've not even used SAS before because we don't, in my university, we don't have SAS, and SAS is not open source. And if you look at this software and some other software that are not mentioned here, they're expensive. Now, coming to open source is a great relief for researchers in Africa and especially for us in developing countries. They will move to the next slide. We're talking about R. I won't be spending much time here, but I got introduced to R in 2012 when I was to start my PhD program in statistics from the University of Ilorin, meaning that at my undergraduate program, how many programs I've done before the PhD, I don't even know about R. Not until recently that we are trying to bring R, some R, into the curriculum using different means because of the techniques we help our students as it's helping us and then move on. And Arab is so is a fantastic language that's very vast in statistical method, machine learning, and graphic analysis and all that. We'll go to the next slide. The advantages are huge in the sense that if we are to go with a paid software, sometimes they have some limitations. But with the R program, with the R language, already somebody have mentioned that because of a lot of, it's a community of contributors. Sometimes I want to, most of the work I'm doing, I'm using R. One of my students, we're working on a panel var, we're using R. I'm doing a work on Bayesian vector regressive model, I'm using R. The advantages are huge, and we are seeing the, it's a great experience using R. Then the next slide. The machine learning. Actually, most of the things I've been doing before now has been on statistical computing in terms of building capacity of students, researchers on how to understand some of the statistical methods we use, how to also get auto have idea in what we call statistical collaborating skills and all that. But already many definitions are out there and we have talked more on this. It's machine learning talks about getting insight from data, where you talk about the training part and then the predicting part. Then the next slide. Yeah, for now, I'm focusing on supervised machine learning. That's what I'm focusing on. in terms of teaching my student, and also when I have opportunity to teach some, when we have a workshop outside the university, we're dealing on the machine, the supervised aspect of machine learning. The next slide, talk about, we have many packages. If I'm teaching myself, I tell them that we have many of them, but I have an interesting one among this, in this list called Carrot. Carrot is a very robust machine learning package. In Carrot, you can do your support version machine. In Carrot, you can do your random forest. In Carrot, you can do your decision tree and so many. And most of the time, if I have opportunity to teach my student and also outside, instead of going to look at many, many packages, we just focus on Carrot. Carrot is very vast in terms of machine learning and all that. The next slide. Now, this is another interesting thing we are trying to put forward to the community of people teaching statistics, data science, and all that. We are coming up with a framework called Team R. The Team R, the T that talks about teach. And the next slide, we'll be looking at different way we have been teaching our teaching. Now, one of the way, since I belong to different platform, this platform is called the LISA. In the LISA, we are a family of labs across African developing countries. Now, not just African country, developing countries. We have a start lab in my university. We have a start lab in India. We have a start lab in Pakistan. We have a start lab in Ghana and many countries. In Nigeria, we have many of them. And these have is really helping us in terms of, because our curriculum does not even have much statistical computing in most of these courses. Through this platform, we use it to teach our students by using the short course, using workshop, and all that. And I don't have much time, but let's go to the next slide. Now, as I mentioned, they introduced me, I am the African session, the chair for African session for International Statistical Computing. Now, what we did, I reached out to this IASC that we don't have African session, and they give us the permission to have what we call African member group. And it is doing a lot of things. What we do through that platform, we have webinars, we have a short course. This is one of the short course we had in April last year. These are the participants. The participants cut across students and also researchers. And because of we had little funding, the program was entirely free. The part of the webinar we had one of it recently. You can see the title. We're talking about data science in academics and also in industry. Then this other picture you see, this is college students. We had a workshop for Northern Region. We're trying to say these students in secondary school need to know, have idea on statistics. Sometimes they don't know what is statistics as a course. And part of our vocation is to also introduce them to a course called statistics. The next slide. Now, this is a workshop we had. In fact, this is one of the first workshop now in machine learning. I was the facilitator. It was held for members of Nigeria Statistical Association. It was this year, September 2022. People that came for this workshop, most of them are from the ministry, government ministry, and from the industry. And it was a lot. We used machine learning using the Carrot. The next slide. These are other way of teaching. The way we teach it, we use real life data sets. Just like my first speaker spoke about, sometimes when we are teaching this thing, we may have data sets online, but sometimes getting Nigeria data sets, sometimes it may be a little bit difficult. But obviously, one of the websites I'm using for financial model is WW West. They have some data set for Nigeria stock. We also try to influence our students that there is feature in statistics, there's also feature in data science. We also have mentoring The last one is relationship. Now, what we do with relationship is that we are trying to tell our student, you can move from theory to practice. Even after you graduate, you can see we can still maintain relationships so that when you have a job out there, you need a resource person, you have an opening for us, you can link up to us, and that can be an avenue to also impact in those settings and quarters. The next slide. Now, we look at the challenges. As I mentioned before, data science is not well integrated into our curriculum. Even in statistical computing with R, sometimes you see people, when you go to some places, you see somebody from economy, somebody from sociology, they're applying a lot of idea in computing, you'll be surprised. But that may not be so for us in Nigeria. But the same way, I'm trying to say that it's a problem. For us to really move to the world of data science, it must be integrated into the curriculum. Then the basic skills, sometimes some people complain that coding could be a little bit stressful. It's a challenge, it's one of the challenges of art. They say coding could be stressful and all that. Then, so far as at now, we really don't have a university that runs BSc data science. And sometimes we want to do it online, it could be expensive. But all the same, we also know that there are some other free online, you can learn some basics. This is a little challenge, and we are looking forward that at some time to come, university will be running data science at BSc level, because it will help us in terms of getting the rudiment and then move to the postgraduate level. The next slide talk about even the university that run data science related courses, they are just, they are not too much, and they run it at postgraduate level. Some are in the Department of Computer Science and all that. We also have one in my university, Nasarawa State University. These are some of the universities that do data science related courses at the postgraduate level. Then the next slide. Now, we have a lot of prospects if we continue this way, since it is interdisciplinary in nature, the data science and then the machine learning. One of the areas we talk about fraud detection. In one of our discussions, somebody mentioned from my country that we have a payment system and there was a fraud that engulfed a lot of funds in billions. And thank God that we've learned some things here, that not just giving everything to the machine, that there should be involvement of the human. You see that fraud detection is very important, which we can also do. Then electoral process. Like one of our lab in Nigeria, in University of Ibadan, was able to have a collaboration with the Independent National Electoral Commission. And the election is coming up next year. And you can see that AI or machine learning can also be used. We have agriculture, we have the climate change. Like the climate change, somebody talk about deforestation. Because of sometimes the cost of gas, cooking gas is there, kerosene is there. And people are going to what is called the charcoal. Charcoal is getting from, they're going to work on the fire wood, burn the wood, and then you get the charcoal. And sometimes when they fall those trees, they may not replant. And we can also use this one to also monitor and also help out. Security problem is there. Medicine and education can also be applied. There are a lot of prospects in terms of machine learning in Nigeria. To conclude, the last slide. In conclusion, it's a call which we are still doing from our own local perspective, that data science components should be integrated in all courses in our tertiary institution. And apart from that, the NUC, which is the National Union of University Commission, should see how to encourage universities to start BSc program in data science. With all this, we hope that the use of data science, both in the academics and in the industry, will be achieved in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Monday, for this very interesting overview of the challenges, prospects, and opportunities as well of machine learning in Nigeria. And I suspect many of the things that you said apply more generally elsewhere as well. So let me Let me start by inviting questions to both Monday and Jabera. You can either raise your hand and we can give you permission to open your mic, or you can put them in the chat and I can then read them aloud to our panelists. While you think about your questions, I'll ask with I'll start with a question about for both our speakers. The question about infrastructure, because we've seen that we have different kind of approaches, for example, to education, but also different kind of needs in Africa, for example. But the assumptions that sometimes are made in the big private companies or Western countries where AI and other machine learning tools are developed are not necessarily always fulfilled. For example, you know, all of these big data sets that require lots of storage capabilities or lots of computer power or lots of processing power, even just to train the models. And so those methods even may not be applicable in a situation where there is perhaps lack of data science education or also lack of infrastructure. So how do you see what is the next step in order to avoid the pitfall of not being able to catch up or lead in AI development, given perhaps infrastructural or educational needs of the moment?
Maybe I can go fast.
Yes, please.
Thank you, Robert. And actually, as part of addressing the infrastructure in the lab, I also forgot to mention that our lab is currently being funded by SIDA and IDRC, and part of the funding we're also putting in place physical infrastructure within the campus, where we are buying a GPU data server so that people can also run the model from within the campus. But also, Robert, maybe something I should mention that, and also share experience and what we have been going through for a couple of 1 year. We know when we won, we are so excited. And as we are working to put a physical infrastructure, we also found a challenge. And one of the challenges we find is that as a government institution, we also need to go through the tendering process with the government. But it also happened that an organization won to supply the devices. And because, you know, in Africa, a few organizations are putting physical infrastructure. So the guy who won the tender was thinking like it's just like an ordinary normal servers, normal machines. And then they found it something different, because things like GPU, which are some of it expensive for an institution to own, it was not something that is possible. And probably, Roberto, I think this has contributed so many for the African, especially Anglophone Africans, to have a rise in uptake of the artificial intelligence, because we have seen a lot of startups struggling so that to have a physical infrastructure or somehow a real infrastructure for them to have simulations and also be able to run their model. So as a lab, we appreciate the support from SIDA, IDRC. We are putting a physical infrastructure within the campus, and we are happy that the infrastructure will be used across the Anglophone Africa. It's not only about Tanzania or East Africa or SADC. We are working for the Anglophone Africa. Thank you.
Thank you, Jabera. That's very interesting. Monday, do you have do you want to add from your perspective?
Yeah. Just as he mentioned, the government in our own part of the country is also trying. We have a funding agency called the TED Fund. They also give they also give priority to infrastructure. Like in my university, we have the ICT center, where you have some set of systems. But apart from that, also in our individual way, also if we get funding, we can also see how to also have some of this infrastructure on our own, and also encourage our students, some of them that may have that are buoyant, they can also get their own, especially the laptop. But just some of the feelers or the feedback from this workshop, I'm seeing that what we also need to do, we need to extend hands to some of these companies, because in our university, the presence of companies are not just there. Because I've gone to some country, something like maybe Nokia, sometimes you see like Microsoft Lab, but in my country, in my university precisely, we don't have such. We hope that in the future, we may also reach out to them to see if they can also support us in terms of infrastructure.
Absolutely. Infrastructure and education, they go hand in hand. Thank you for that. Gibbs, do you want to ask your question? Please go ahead. Gibbs, we can't hear you very well. Maybe it's a microphone problem. It's a lot of echo.
Okay.
Again?
Can you hear me now?
Very difficult. There's a lot of distortion. Maybe the phone headphones, maybe?
Is it better?
Yeah, much better. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
My question will to Mondia and Jabira. I just want to know, I mean, we know that data science and machine learning is a very applied field, and usually you can get a lot of tutorial from online, but usually they don't teach you the fundamental aspect, like maybe the mathematics behind all those algorithms and all those stuff. I just want to know, on your own activity, are you also trying to teach the student the intuition behind the method, like before using a package in R or any of those stuff? Are you also trying to give them, okay, this is the idea, this is the mathematics behind it, in order for them to have a very deep understanding of all those algorithms? Yeah, that's my question.
Can I go ahead?
Yes, please, Bonde, go ahead. Thank you, Gibbs.
Okay. Thank you for that question. Actually, before now, that has been a challenge. Sometimes in academics, we just focus on the theory without giving the hands-on, which is the practical. Part of what we do is to teach them the theory and then go for the hands-on. Because in they are majoring, like, let's take for instance, my students are majoring in the field of mathematics and statistics. Therefore, I'm going to teach them more to have that basic. But somebody that is coming to apply it, we may just teach the peripheral and then teach the hands-on. Just as you have asked the question, we teach them the theory also.
So there's the two aspects together.
Yes, the two aspects together.
Thank you. Gilbert, do you want to ask you, go ahead and unmute yourself?
Yeah. Yes, maybe before that, Albert, I wanted to add on what Gibson
asked.
As part of the RAB, the capacity building is one of the very high section that we are giving priority. We don't teach them just to analyze data. We teach them how to develop model, how to create algorithms, and also how to read and existing algorithms. It happened. Someone is using it. So as part of the RAB, we are building that capacity because we understand it's very critical for the access and the uptake of AI, especially in the Anglophone Africa. Thank you.
Thank you, Jabira, for that. Gilbert, please go ahead.
Thank you for the presentation. Actually, my question will go to Dr. Jabira Matagora. I wanted to ask on this issue of the AI for lab. I saw there's different section, and one of it I saw was on the data sets in Africa. But again, I don't know what is his take on this, because the issue of data set in Africa, it's really a complicated issue because it cuts across different challenges. And one of it is funding. Another thing is, of course, the lack of capacity of people probably to collect the data that is required. And for that element to be met, then these other underlying challenges have to be addressed. So I don't know how Jabira Matagaro is thinking about this, because if really this has to be a success,
then those issues have really to be addressed through collaboration, partnership, and etc. So I don't know what is his take on this matter. Back to you.
Thank you.
Yes, I think I can go, Roberto.
Please go ahead, Jabera. Yes, please.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Yeah, actually, you are right. As I mentioned, it's not only about the data set. AI machine learning is not a one-man show. It's something that needs a collaborative and many stakeholders. It's like a multi-stakeholder initiatives. So as part of the lab, when we started, we also brought the government on board because we also noted that you cannot have an extensive usage of the data set if you don't have policies and the regulation in place, like personal data protection rights, you know, our policies or registrations. So we acknowledged that. And in my last presentation, I also called upon many other stakeholders to join hand with us. We are the only artificial intelligence for development lab in the Anglophone Africa, supported by SIDA and the IDRC. And we would appreciate to have many stakeholders joining so that we can have an unexpected impact in the field of artificial intelligence and machine learning, because we understand this field is the cornerstone for the realization of the fourth industrial revolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Jabera. Yeah, many challenges there, but hopefully working together in partnership can absolutely help on all of these fronts. Marco, Teresa, did you have any questions, anything you want to ask from our speakers so far?
Please. Hello?
Monday, yeah, go ahead. If you want to add something, please, from your perspective, yes. Absolutely. Yeah.
And Arinze is asking what is our efforts in ensuring that BSc data science and all that should start. Like my university, we are making effort now. We have gotten the curriculum for the data science, but we want to push it further to see how it will be approved by NUC. I know that UI also, they're also making some effort also on seeing how data science in BSc data science can also commence. Those are the efforts. Thank you.
Thank you, Monde. I see a question from Matteo Marcuzzo in the chat. Do you have any issues with students and practitioners moving to different countries to look for better resources, or really brain drain? In Italy, for example, we often hear about human capital flight, where people with advanced training move somewhere else, or maybe they go somewhere else for training and then they don't come back, and you lose you know, this brain drain problem. What's your take on this? Starting from Monday, brain drain, yeah. Brain drain.
For me, I'm not looking at it from a brain drain perspective, because we are trying to struggle from Africa. If I see an offer, let's say from US, to say come over, come and learn some things, I don't mind going there. Then if the country don't want to help us out, we are willing to go out there and contribute. Just as we have mentioned, even for me to be connected to this platform, I need to have I buy my own data set, that's our internet facility, my laptop, my own. Then when I see offer from the white outside world, even this one is not part of the this program you invited me to come and you selected me to attend. It's part of capacity building. Therefore, if I go to any country for training and even stay there to work, I'm not seeing it as drain, but I'm seeing it as capacity building. Thank you.
Absolutely. But I guess, you know, if people go for training and then they don't come back, then it becomes perhaps a drain. Jabera, what's your take on this?
Yeah, actually, I wanted to mention on the same point that if people go for their training and then they don't come back, then it's become a challenge. But there is an opportunity of engaging the diaspora. And I'm also happy to say that I'm working with the diaspora team to see how we can collaborate with the diaspora around the world who are from Tanzania. So I think that is also another angle to see that. But maybe I could also share experience from the lab. Our lab, AI4D, multidisciplinary research lab, has around 14 team members, and the PI and the lab coordinator, the PI went abroad for his PhD and he came back to the university. And also the lab coordinator went abroad for his PhD and he came back to the university. And then I also went to many other countries just for searching knowledge, and we came back to the country, to the university. And then after coming back, we started collaborating as faculty members to put together a proposal which was strong and somehow competitive, and then we won. Maybe a message I could mention is that even if you go abroad for knowledge searching, but it's possible also to support your home country on the knowledge perspective. Thank you.
Exactly.
Thank you. Thank you both. Let me now close for now the discussion, but we'll reopen it later at the end when we'll bring together all the four speakers of today. For now, thank you very much, Monday and Jabera, for both of your excellent and very interesting presentations. For the second part of today's session, we're going to hear from the perspective from India. And our next speaker is Dr. Anup Kumar Das, who is an information specialist working with the Center for Studies in Science Policy at, and I'm sorry if my pronunciation here is incorrect, Jawaharlal Nehru University in India. He has a PhD from Jadavpur University in Kolkata, and his research interests revolve around open science, open access, and research data, digital inclusion in data science and information policies. Is the joint convener of Open Access India, an advocacy group for promotion of open access and open science. Anup is also the co-chair of the co-data task group working towards a paradigm shift for open data in planning smart and resilient cities. He was a consultant to UNESCO New Delhi and the Commonwealth of Learning. And we're going to learn now from him about machine learning as envisaged in India's AI policies. And I got your slides here. Anup, you please go ahead and unmute yourself while I share your screen. Welcome.
Yeah, if you have, actually my bandwidth is low, so can you share my slides?
Yeah, I'm sharing. I'm going to share your slides now. Can you see them?
Yeah, I can see.
Okay, let me go to full. What is it? What screen? Here we are. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you all, course directors, for inviting me to give this case study on India. And this is about the India's AI policies and machine learning policies. So, next slide, please. So, we just started our AI policies. This is one website, oecd.ai. That is OECD Policy Observatory on Artificial Intelligence. So, and from India, we see that 23 policies are mapped, and most of them are from the government sites, and few of them are from the corporations and other practitioners. So, this is the starting point when we can see that where to start about the AI policies for India. So next slide, please. So we just saw that we have one major policy document, which is called National Strategy for Artificial Intelligence, and it is hashtag AI for All. And this policy document was released in June 2018, and it is released by Niti Aayog, one entity under Government of India. And this policy document focused on five sectors that are envisioned to benefit the most of from the AI in solving societal needs. So they are mostly focusing on the sustainable development goals, and which are upcoming for the our different sustainability issues, particularly which are related to healthcare, agriculture, or we can see that zero hunger or the sustainable development goal is there, and education, that quality education. Then we also have some goals for the smart cities, infrastructure, and smart mobility and transportation. So all these five sectors these policies presently covering, and will come more details about the sectors, particularly healthcare, agriculture, and education in other slides. So next slide, please. So NITI Aayog, this think tank, also released one document called Responsible AI Approach Document for India, Part 1, Principles for Responsible AI. And this document was released in February 2021, and it has 7 system considerations and few societal considerations. So 7 system considerations are that understanding AI systems functioning for safe and reliable deployment, and post-deployment, can the relevant stakeholders of the AI system understand why a specific decision was made, and consistency across stakeholders, incorrect decisions leading to exclusion from access to services or benefits. And yesterday, we had one presentation about the food distribution system in India, particularly one state from Tamil Nadu. So our speaker discussed about this thing, that social exclusion from the access to services or benefits. So this is also part of the system consideration. And next consideration is accountability of AI decisions, then privacy risks and security risks. So these 7 are very important considerations from the systems perspective. And from the society's perspective, this document talks about that malicious use of AI and impact on jobs, particularly sometimes we see that many news are coming that many people will lose their jobs due to the implementation of AI and machine learning in the industries. On the other hand, some other news also carrying that some more jobs will be created due to the implementation of AI and machine learning. Next slide. So the part 2 of the discussion paper, that is called Responsible AI Approach Document for India, Operationalizing Principles for Responsible AI. And this was released in August 2021 by NITI Aayog. And it has 2 aspects, one for the government and government enterprises, and second is for the private sector and research institutions. From the government setup, that designing ideal regulatory and policy interventions, creating awareness, accessibility and capacity building, and facilitating precise procurement strategies. So these are the operationalizing principles for the government. So we have a federal structure, we have state government as well as central government. At the grassroots level, we have local government. So all will follow that this kind of operational principles for adopting responsible AI. And then for the private sector and research institution, so some of the principles are that incentivizing ethics by design, creating frameworks for compliance with relevant AI standards and guidelines, and the promotion of responsible AI practices in research. So we are having around more than 100 institutions, where both private as well as public research institutions were working on the various aspects of machine learning, artificial intelligence, and data science. So they will also adopt these principles for responsible AI. Next slide, please. So the third discussion paper was released in this month, November 2022, and it is called Adopting the Framework Use Case Approach on Facial Recognition Technology. So this is open for the public comments till 30th November, and it provided a case study of Digi Jatra program, which is facial recognition kind of program for the airports, Indian airports. So some of the airports also carrying that prototype of the DigiJatra, and where the travelers or flyers, they can download the DigiJatra app on their smartphone, and they can proceed with the boarding of the airplanes. So there will be smooth process for the DigiJatra users, and they have to face less number of queues for getting the access to the boarding gate. So in this particular policy discussion papers also, some examples are face recognition technology systems deployed in India. So that is mostly for the surveillance purpose from the law and order agencies, and also from other agencies who are having some public interfaces. So that is the discussion paper which is presently seeking public comments. So next slide, please. Very recently, in September 2022, UNESCO New Delhi office, they released one 2022 State of the Education Report for India, Artificial Intelligence in Education. So this report is produced in collaboration with the Ministry of Education of Government of India. And it also provides different recommendations, particularly 10 recommendations for the AI education in India. And some of the recommendations are like that consider the ethics of artificial intelligence in education as an utmost priority. Rapidly provide an overall regulatory framework for artificial intelligence in education, effective public-private partnerships, ensure that all students and teachers have access to latest technology, expand AI literacy efforts, and similar other things, including the ownership of data by the students. So they'll cover most of the areas which are for the AI education, and that is not only for the school level, that is also for the tertiary level and also vocational level. So all kind of educational systems will be following these recommendations which are mentioned in the UNESCO report. Next one, please. Also, there is one industry body called NASSCOM, which is catering to the information technology and information service industry. Yeah. And they are partnering with the Government of India, and they released one NASSCOM Responsible AI Resource Kit in October 2022. And this is released to seed the adoption of responsible AI at scale. So upscaling the responsible AI across the country with their member industries, and to harness the power of AI ethically. So NASSCOM also has different industry partners for the development of this responsible AI toolkit. And it is also helping prioritizing user trust and safety. So this way, the industry will adopt the responsible AI, and they're sensitizing their own stakeholders. Next slide, please. Also, there is one national AI portal, which is AI.gov.in. This portal was launched on 30th May 2020. And it is a joint initiative of Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology and National E-Governance Division and NASSCOM, so industry body. And this portal serves as a central hub for AI-related news, learning, articles, events, and activities in India and beyond. So particularly all the policy documents and all the documents related to AI and machine learning in the industry. So those are available from this website. And they also maintain social media accounts like LinkedIn and Twitter, where we'll get more information about the AI activities, machine learning activities in the industries across the country. Next slide, please. There is one new publication which was launched during the Independence Day, and which is called 75 at 75, that AI startups booklet in India. So it showcases 75 AI startups, and according to the Economic Survey of India and 2021-22, India had at least one startup in 555 districts. Most venture capital funding is now going to AI projects in the e-commerce, banking, and healthcare sector. So in some specific sectors, we are having more startups. And in 2021, there was funding of $1,100 million in Indian AI startups in the field of AI and analytics. So business analytics also part of this group. So we saw increased amount of funding from the venture capitalist as well as from the investors, and it cost around $1,100 million. Next one, please. So India, this portal also showcase some of the startups, startup of the week, and presently it is showing logi.ai. This is one startup. It was founded in 2018. And this is an AI-based digital patient platform for preventive care from home at zero cost for users. So it is kind of smart mobile enabled applications where patient can see information about the healthcare, and they can get some information about preventive healthcare. Next one, please. Also, in the last month, we had National Cyber Security Awareness Month, and AI is also helpful for the cybersecurity. AI and smart algorithms are playing a significant role in analyzing network traffic and learning to recognize patterns that suggest nefarious intentions. Some of the most significant applications of AI that we'll see develop in 2022 are likely to be in this area. So these are the cybersecurity areas which are being focus, that is faster detection, phishing detection, network security, secure authentication, and preventing online frauds. So these are the high focus areas, and National Cyber Security Awareness Month focused on these aspects. And AI will be, AI applications will be there for mitigating these issues. Next one, please. So in the first document, the AI strategy document, we focused on the healthcare. So there are many AI-based applications available for the healthcare, like effective eye care screening tool using AI, and AI-enabled mental health care, that is for improved predictability, greater accuracy, support empathy, and 24/7 availability of chatbots. So this is also promoted during the World Mental Health Day last month. So also we have one app or one tool to identify probable COVID-19 cases. So this is also AI-based. And this tool will combine an analysis of solicited cough sounds as an object measure, allowing it to identify the probable COVID-19 cases. Also, there are some applications like AI-powered stroke treatment and early detection software for breast cancer. All these are currently developed in India, and these are being promoted by different startups. Next one, please. So, India AI portal and also Government of India, they are promoting laboratory to market initiatives. So, whichever is developed at the laboratory or institutional laboratory, machine learning or AI laboratories, so those products should be reached to the common people. So that's why they have one lab to market initiative. So last year they had received over 50 applications from renowned institutions like Indian Institute of Technology Kharagpur, IIT Rupar, then Indian Institute of Science Bangalore, and more. So top applicants were incubated in NASCOM 10,000 Startup Incubation Program. And this year also, they are seeking new applications for these initiatives. And they have extended the last date till 15th of November 2022. So they are looking for the academic innovator and perfect opportunity to gain right visibility and industry exposure for your groundbreaking AI solutions. So this can be in any areas like healthcare, cybersecurity, or agriculture, or many other areas which are mentioned in the policy document. Next one, please. So in conclusion, so we can say that responsible AI and also responsible machine learning support UN Sustainable Development Goals, particularly goals related to good health, quality education, clean water, zero hunger, food security, and also innovation, foster innovation, making cities and human settlement inclusive, safe, and resilient, and for the climate actions like energy and environment related actions, also will have some AI applications. And public and private sector corporations in India are expected to undertake competitive strategies in implementing responsible AI for mitigating sustainable futures. AI ML researchers, science communicators, and influential professionals have been engaged in sharing knowledge resources through open access information portals. We talked about one portal, India AI. There are many other portals related to science and technology communications. So they are also carrying different news about AI and ML applications. And these individuals or researchers also have initiated awareness raising on responsible AI besides other aspects of data-driven decision making. So we already have some ecosystem of having the people along the responsible AI and responsible machine learning. So we'll have more initiatives in different sectors in coming years. So thank you all for this presentation.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Anu, for this wonderful overview of so many different aspects. No doubt we will talk more about it in a minute. So please stay with us. We'll come back to you and the rest of the panel at the end of the next talk, which is the final talk for today and for the week. And the final talk is by Dr. Sharik Hassan Manazir, who is a science, technology and society scholar and a researcher in the area of digital democracy and exclusion in South Asia. He's currently with the Bharati Institute of Public Policy at the Indian School of Business in India and looks after the course curriculum as well as the training of senior government officials. Sharik has a PhD from Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. He's a 2013 UN Volunteer Award recipient and is a member of the Science and Democracy Network at Harvard University. He's also a member of GigaNet, the Internet Society, and a founding member of the Digital Inclusion Research Forum in India. And his research interests more broadly are in the digital governance, inclusion, and democracy studies. And his talk today is going to be on digital democracy and exclusion biases and impact analysis of MyGov portal of the government of India. Sharik, I'm going to share your slides in a minute. I have them here. First of all, welcome. Great to have you here. Thank you for accepting invitation. And I'll bring up your slides.
Can I share my screen if that's fine?
If you want to, that's fine. If that's okay with you, yes.
I can.
Go ahead. Yeah. Okay, no problem. Sure.
Just let me see. Do I have access for that?
Yes, you should. You're a co-host, aren't you?
Okay.
Yes, you should be able to do that. Mm-hmm.
Just a second. Because I'm kind of habitual of using Teams, so...
Exactly. Yeah, there's two different camps, isn't it? There's a green share button at the bottom. Can you see the share screen?
I can see. Before I share the PPT, let me thank everyone at ICTP and especially Professor Marco, Professor Roberto, and everyone there at Italy for organizing this workshop. It's actually very rare when you see people from pure science reaching out to academic work and all the thing going around, especially in digital area. I have been working in this domain. To be very honest, I'm not very satisfied with the research work that we see every day around. Most of the time, it kind of feel bad when you see a lot of repetition in the work and the lack of connect with the pure science in academic domain when we deal with a lot of research work. Especially, this is my personal view, the whole of the machine learning and digital humanity, it has to one day go back to pure science. And this initiative was really a refreshing thing to, and that was the reason why I thought, come on, let's have an interaction, let's share some work. So I will just begin my activity. Okay, I hope you all can see my slides.
Yes, we can.
Yeah, so I'll be talking about digital democracy and exclusion biases. In my talk, I'll briefly share one of my studies of the MyGov portal. I'll tell you what it is in India and how the government is using the e-participation platform for public policy consultation. And how machine learning can, improve the situation in these kind of portals in South Asia. What are the, areas where improvement is required? And I'll just take you through in the next 15 minutes with how the public policy domain has evolved globally, academic work especially, and how we have reached and where we have reached in India in terms of academia and in terms of practice. Just a second. Okay, so what you're seeing on screen is the, conventional public policy making cycle. So it's basically proposed by Nachmanides and Flemminger. So the system begins with agenda setting, policy discussion, policy formulation, policy acceptance, and it ends with the, policy feedback and evaluation. It's basically a very conventional way. So when public policy academia differentiated from the public administration academia, seeking a need for a wider discourse on public policy. That's how from here the discourse shifted. Just a second. Over here you can see various theoretical and academic literature that came up, especially with the theoretical frameworks from across the globe that discussed about how public policy evolves, how people participation is incorporated, how technology as a tool is incorporated, and at various and at what stage that technology comes into picture in public policy for people consultation and government consultation, starting from Laswell in 1956 to Buckland in 2005. And I think it's not till Buckland we have been seeing a lot of theoretical framework evolving day to day. This is a very basic evolution of the conventional public policy framework, where now when people who are working with big data and machine learning, now there's a basic discussion that, as compared to previous time, now since everything is available, every information is available in real time, we can do intervention at any stage of public policy formulation, and we can make the whole process more holistic, robust, and beneficial for private corporation, society, government, whatever. Now, when we talk about, digital platforms, the debate and academic discussion and policy discussion on digital platforms, these are known basically by three, there's basically three names which is used in common parlance in academic world. One is internet-based platform or digital platform. A more polished literature pronounces it an e-participation platform. Then there's cyber ecosystem. All three of them, they mean the same thing. Use and study its use and study basically divided into three structures. One is the evaluation study. So most of the time you have government to private corporation and large big consulting firms which conduct online and offline surveys, and they come up with a set of reports, consultation papers, drafts saying, we conducted evaluation studies and these are the findings, these are the consultation works. Then you have e-governance platforms. These are the platforms, and by and large, we all know across the globe, every country and every government have public service delivery platforms, and that's where people go for basic services to visa application. You go and you apply, and we all have a set of e-governance platform in every country. The third category is the e-participation platform. This e-participation, the whole concept of e-participation comes from digital e-people participation in public policy formulation, starting from, Laswell, and then I'll tell you if I remember it. So the whole idea was, when you have people participation in public decision making, starting from agoras, ancient time agoras, to right now when government take any decision, and they have to justify that why you took any particular decision. They have to in a conventional legacy system, they used to run polling and consultations, manual consultations, and as the digital platforms evolved with time from e-governance to more interactive versions with more enabled machine learning and capabilities. And to be very honest, when I'm discussing machine learning, I'm not reaching to AI. When I say machine learning, it's a road to AI, might not into AI. So e-participation platforms are basically meant for people to come across digital platform for various purposes. So these platforms could be, social media platforms like Twitter, Facebook, where you go, these are run by private corporations. Then I'll share in later on slides that various governments, they today have their own e-participation platform where they run online consultations to have involve people directly into the interaction for a quick decision making and judgment. And from there, the whole discourse of, you know, digital ethics comes into picture, that how valuable, how useful, how fruitful that decision or when we participation comes up, which we'll be discussing in the next slide. Okay, so what is the research gap and what is the research that is available right now? When we talk about, you know, people participate, digital participation platforms, so there's a lot of research work across the globe on e-governance platforms in various ways. You know, quantitative analysis, qualitative analysis. You have government ministerial website content analysis. You have, plethora of research on social media platforms. They fund researchers across the globe for various things. Then you have, privately owned e-participation platform where, you have various e-petition platforms in India and even abroad, where if you have certain cause or there's some issue which you want to discuss and you feel that, there is no space in public domain to do, you go and you do the discussion, but then it's owned by private corporations and individual. But when you talk about government owned e-participation platform, there's a huge academic gap. Because, conventionally it comes under government domain. So study and analysis is less, first of all. To reach out to content analysis and everything, it becomes a tough task. So it's less accessible, but then it has its own set of benefit analysis, which we'll see. Now, we talk about e-participation platforms. So from, we have it in USA, UK, Finland, Germany, Australia. And I'm really not sure whether it is there in Italy or not. I have my language limitations, but someday if there's someone who'd like to collaborate, we can probably have a joint study for e-participation platform in Italy, if there is one. Okay. So for now I can talk about South Asia, which I have been broadly studying. There is no specific people party digital e-participation platform which is being run by government in South Asia, especially when we study Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, or for the matter even Pakistan. In India, we have MyGov. MyGov is basically a digital participation platform. Let me explain how it works. So, for example, if government wants to come up with any specific policy, like Dr. Anoop, who was discussing just before me, so he shared with you the AI consultation papers. So these consultation papers, if the government come, any department or ministry of government comes up with these consultation papers, they not only go on the departmental website, they also go on the MyGov platform. So what a person can do is, if I feel that, this specific part of the document has some issue, or it could have been done in a better way as an academician or as a just a concerned citizen, I can simply go over there, I can post the comments, and then I can expect a feedback, and I can, and that thing gets incorporated into the draft. So, and that's just one example. So when I was doing my study, so I started my study with, there was this thing called a smart city campaign in India, where central government decided that though they were having different levels of smart cities in India, but then it was one of the initial, campaign to start and designate official smart cities in various states in India. And what should be the policies for those smart cities? So the concerned ministry, they went on MyGov platform, city-wise, and then they posted and they asked the concerned department of the local government to, come up with a policy draft and post it on the platform so that the people from that city can actually suggest, improvise, or recommend things, or if there's something which they feel should not be there, they can suggest to please remove it. Now, this was a good opportunity to, study how people participation is actually going on, with India being, one of the largest population, largest internet base. And this was a good opportunity to map how, things are evolving and how it could be a case study for foreign countries also. So what I did was, it was a mixed methods approach where, starting from GIS mapping, literature review of socioeconomic caste census. Then we theorize a formula, how to we will calculate the volume of digital people participation on these platforms, ranging from content analysis of the whole comment sheets on the, over the Smart City campaign, going towards the textual analysis of the various response and, you know, the nuisance of indicators, mapping the gender, mapping the, you know, tone of the literature, mapping the nature of the response, usability of the comments. So that's how we proceeded with the research. Now, there were two public policy, you know, cycle that I showed to you. One is the conventional one, then the other one is where now in a common discussion, most often the AI researchers or machine learning researchers post. Over here, this is the, you know, if you can see the screen, this is the how I mapped through my own research, that's how right now the public policy formulation cycle works in India, where you have a designated public sphere where public interest group and political parties exist and people still go. Then you have digital sphere where you have government enabled e-participation platform, then you have private only participation platform where people go and where people post their queries. These queries, they culminate and they go to government in various forms and capacities to different, you know, layers of the government, from executive, legislature, judiciary. And from there, it goes toward the citizen service, you know, portals, whether it's e-government projects, you know, legacy-based government projects. And that's how the cycle operates. Now, I hope you all know the person in the picture, either way, famous guitarist. So I call it Brew Effect, and how, that's how I, you know, start the digital ethics discourse. So, you know, what starts with is the bias relevance, with no offense to Brew, but then bias, relevance, exclusion, accuracy, and uncertainty. So, like I said at the beginning of my talk, when most of all, when we talk about, you know, machine learning and AI, there are two problems in the whole, like, you know, discourse is, one, it's disconnected with pure science. Second, we think that it's going to solve all the problems of the world without mapping the complexities of the problem. And these are the issues which I thought that they are the prominent one when we deal with, you know, digital government-enabled e-participation platforms too. Like, you can use machine learning over there to various stages, and that can, you know, improve the reliability as well as, you know, outcome of the policies, and if taken care of. Now, just a second. Okay, so, you know, when you talk about machine learning and the ethical, you know, dilemmas, so first of all is the data-driven decision-making. Now, how will machine learning respond to these platforms, and how can we incorporate in the whole, the debate of, you know, digital platforms largely, and people participation in governance and democracies through digital platforms specifically. Because, you know, if we use it in a positive way, it can increase the reliability and trust of people, you know. I'll give you one example. So if I post one response that this policy draft has this issue, or it can be improved in this way. Now, if you have, you know, 10 million users, and if you have, even if you have like 2 lakh or 3 lakh comments, it becomes tough for a department to respond to every comment, or, you know, go through all the document and incorporate all the changes at one place. And I'm talking about MyGov being the only portal, like just Dr. Anup was discussing, there are different portals. So we can use machine learning very well if we try to, you know, incorporate these changes to make it a more reliable aspect. And now moving to exclusion. Now, so officially speaking, theoretically speaking, first of all, digital exclusion is somewhat, you know, we have yet not defined and differentiated digital divide and digital exclusion, especially in the South Asian context. So a larger debate, and when I talk about, digital divide discourse, I'm talking about a majority of the academic work, which does not deal with South Asia. It talks about the issue of accessibility. So the idea is if the digital devices are accessible, probably it may be solving the problem, but that's not the case. When we talk about South Asian countries, we have different layers of issues. So if you go through the whole social identity theory, which Amad Sen talks about in his work, you realize that, you know, there are layers of issues ranging from gender, demographic location, age group, physical health, mental health, caste, religion, social barriers. And these social exclusion aspects, they get, you know, extrapolated over digital spheres.
And Sharik, sorry for interrupting. Do you think you could conclude the next couple of minutes or so? So we'll leave some space for questions as well.
Sorry, I'll just try to. Okay, so
It's fine. We're absolutely fine. But if you could wrap up in 2 minutes or so, we can have some space for questions and discussion as well, which would be nice.
Sure. So, Thank you. So
that's great.
So that's how it is. Then we have e-participation. So the reliability of people participation, where a lot of said echo chamber, is a common context understanding on digital democracy academia that, you know, people do participate, people do suggest their recommendations, but are they being considered in the final drafts of the policy that comes out or not is still a question. Now, this is the main issue. So you have digital divide, you have policy trepidation, accountability, data privacy, social identity, social exclusion, and digital identity issues, which these platforms face that can be resolved with machine learning. But then machine learning has its own set of ethical issues like we discussed right now, and probably we'll discuss in the question hour. And that's where the question ends. So I'm not concluding my work. I'm just leaving the dais open for, you know, extrapolation and discussion across the globe for everyone who's listening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This was another excellent set of perspectives and stimulating reflections. So thank you very much for leaving it perfectly open, poised open, and so we can go straight into the discussion. So thank you. And thank you, Anup, as well, for both of your really interesting talks. So we have about 15 minutes together. And so I would like to open up the discussion to, first of all, to questions about the two talks we just heard, but then more generally to questions about any of the issues that we've been touching upon with all of the panelists and the speakers for this session, and it will include also Marco and Teresa in the discussion. So there was a question here in the chat. I start from that, for a question for Anup. What in your, but obviously anybody else, please feel free to contribute your perspective. What in your viewpoint can countries in the global south do to accelerate machine learning or AI adoption and catch up with the global north? So that's a really, really important, really deep question. Let's start from Anup. If you have a, if you want to give us your perspective, what can Global South do to catch up? And
yeah, actually, I feel that we have a network of Global South institutions. So there are many platforms out there available. So we can utilize those platforms for capacity building and also awareness raising and policy making about the AI and ML related things. And in India, we also get different ministries. So they are also involved in South-South collaboration and South-South cooperation. And we can engage with those kind of activities. So different bilateral or multilateral initiatives which are available with us. So also TWA is also having some scholarships available for the Global South researchers. They can visit our laboratories where researching on ML and AI related areas. So we can also seek some kind of collaboration through availing the funding from TWAs and other agencies also.
Thank you. Jabera, did you want to come in?
Yes, I just want to mention that, yes, if you compare the uptake of AI in the Globe South with the Globe North, sometimes you may want to give up, but we are also trying to do our best so that we are able to join the rest. So I just wanted to mention that the artificial intelligence for development in the Anglophone Africa is also working to make sure that we are able to bridge that. And we also have to collaborate with the Global North in order to increase the capacity building and the uptake of artificial intelligence in Africa in general. Thank you.
Absolutely, thank you. And you're right, we must not give up. There are so many problems that sometimes you think we want to give up, but that's absolutely what we must not do. Anybody else wants to come in on this question? Monday or Sharik, your perspective on what can the Global South do? And is it, my question, is it the responsibility of the Global South to do something, or connected to this question is the question of, you know, it's been mentioned before, the interplay between private sector and public administration, public government, but then public, private sector help or support usually comes with strings attached. And so that's another interesting perspective, you know, whatever the private sector gives, usually they want something in return.
See, first of all, the whole AI research or the digital humanities research as of now, wherever across the globe, and I'm talking about South Asia, and this trend has came to South Asia from, you know, global torchbearers of academic work. The privately funded research, like you said, Roberto, you know, there's a string attached to it. So there's the area where you're not supposed to go. There's the area where there's no benefit of going. And these are the gray areas which can actually help academically in, you know, making the system more robust. So I agree with Dr. Anoop what he said about, you know, what, like, for example, in India, the capacity building at various ministry and government level, the things are going on. But then the problem with the digital ecosystem studies and implementation is we have somewhat moved away, you know, the conventional ways of research, of reaching out to problem, and, you know, the academic work, the approach of academic work that used to be is not there right now. So I'll just share one of my experiences with one of the leading universities. We were discussing about one of the projects to, and, you know, this was an informal discussion. It was like, there's one large multinational digital company that's going to fund, and then, you know, we have to do this and we can do this. And this happens with more or less all the researchers who are dealing with. And that's why you will see the implementation and applicability of AI has somewhat limited to the benefit of largely how it will help the corporations and industry. And the focus is on more on that, because that's from where your majority of your donors are coming up. So how it can be helped in a common parlance to society is not being discussed. Like, for example, metaverse. Okay. Metaverse has benefits, but then there's a lot of issue which is being discussed globally right now. And somewhere down the line, there's no research center which is actually ready to even talk about those issues, and let's forget about, you know, having a fellowship to discuss and, you know, study those issues. So there's a problem. That's like in the beginning of my talk, I said that academic work is required in digital sphere, and if we cannot learn something from pure science, at least we can learn how we can be neutral and approach the problem rather than jumping to conclusion just because there's a donor thing going on around.
Thank you. Monday, did you have something to add from your perspective to this topic?
Okay. From our perspective, I think collaboration will still help us out between the South and the North. Collaboration will be very important at this point. Just like I'm working with some people out there. Because they are out there in the South, we are still collaborating and we are making progress from the North. Collaboration is a way forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Jaber, did you want to add anything?
No, I actually wanted to support what Manda is mentioning that and collaboration, as Mark was also mentioning on the Sustainable Development Goals, I think is on 17. So it could also be included. I remember a few of us mentioned that. So it sounds to be as an alternative solution to bridge the gap between North and South, especially on the emerging technologies. Thank you.
Yes, absolutely. There's a question from Teresa Tusharik, in particular on the echo chambers. How are the echo chambers considered in the analysis of the government participation platforms? And I was interested also, I don't know if you were here, Sharik, for the talk by Petra yesterday, when she talked about their collaborative crowdsourcing, shall we call it, approach to FAIR AI. So this government platform seemed to be a very interesting way, perhaps, of doing some of that work as well, depending on participation and biases and self-selection and so on. So Teresa's question is around echo chambers. How are that dealt with?
Okay, so the whole digital democracy aspect, there's a lot of work from Anne McIntosh, if you want to have a brief reference, and one more scholar, I'll just share in the link if I remember his name. Mostly Anne McIntosh's work is there, and that's where her work is mostly used in a lot of UN report and UN, e-governance survey and all, they quote her. Now, talking about eco chamber, even in the normal democratic process where people participation is discussed in political science academia, this whole notion of echo chamber is there. Now, like I said, when technology came into picture and the whole problem got escalated, the issue of echo chamber too got escalated. When we talk about, people participation platform being run by government, and there's always an intention, there's no doubt that we can think that, the intention is not good, but then government always wants to reach out to it people and they want to have a better access to people for various policy issues. Now, the echo chamber discussion comes into picture. Why? Because there is a sense of lack of, credibility that has been there academically in past, where if you remember, I don't know how it works in in India, conventionally there used to be a basic consultation. So if there is a policy issue, like if there is a policy draft on AI, there is a website, you go and put your comment. There is MyGov platform, you go and put your comment. But before these platforms were in picture, there used to be a department. We are 50, 20 people, we go there, there used to be a roundtable discussion, you put them, and you do not know how much of your inputs were actually being considered into the debate and discussion, and most importantly, into the final draft. Now, when we talk about digital platform, so if I'm putting up my effort and if I'm going on the platform and reading the whole draft and suggesting some changes, as a citizen, it is my right to know what part of my suggestion was actually taken. This is from people's perspective. And this is a very basic understanding. But from government perspective, you have to understand that if you start, taking every individual's perspective into consideration, without keeping a track who is a specialist of that specific domain and who is not a specialist of that particular domain, and that's the whole dichotomy issue comes into picture. And I feel that a machine learning, a responsible machine learning, can actually solve this issue. Like, for example, if we can have instant reward for our food services and, you know, delivery services, if we want, we can have an instant reward on the suggestion that we post on, you know, these platforms. But again, the idea is how we can actually put it on the platform into reality so that the situation improves. And
thank you, Sharik. Sorry, I wanted to go to Anoop because we've got only a few minutes in closing. I'd like to go and round the panelists once more. Sorry, thank you very much for this very, very interesting answer. Anoop, you want to come in on this? And then there's a question for you in the chat as well.
Yeah. Actually, so I'm talking about the echo chamber. So we have very robust kind of independent think tanks. They are also discussing on the issues related to AI and machine learning in the society. Particularly, there is one think tank called Center for Internet and Society. They are providing different inputs for the policy documents. So I think this kind of discussion at the civil society level is happening. So my government is one platform which is seeking inputs from the citizens, but they are not always publishing the citizens' viewpoints on the platform always. But we can see that in the public domain, different civil society organizations also putting their opinions or views on different public policy documents. So this way, we can interact with the government. Thank you.
Thank you. And Anoop, since you are you have the floor, there is a question for you in the chat specifically. Do you face any difficulty or challenges to get the data sets related to crimes in India? This is for the cybercrime methodology, AI application sphere.
Actually, there is one agency called National Crime Control Bureau, and they maintains the data sets for different states. So that researchers can seek access to the data sets, and that is possible. So only they are providing to the where authenticated researchers, not to any individual, only for the researchers. They are providing the data sets. So we can analyze the data from the NCRB portal. I think that is possible.
Okay. Thank you. And so one final question then for all of our panelists. I think it's a very, you know, it's a question that would merit an entire discussion. But the question is around what can be done to bridge the digital divide and exclusion biases to accelerate AI ML adoption to achieve these the development goals that we've been discussing. So let me go to Monday first. What can be done to accelerate the bridge building?
Okay, I think what I think can accelerate all this is, I think one of the talk was on there should be transparency, there should be fairness, and one of the qualities they mentioned. I think if those things are put in place, those biases may be reduced. I think so.
Thank you. Jabera?
Yes, I think using the human-centered approach could also help to address the digital divide that they mentioned, because people will have more trust on the technology and also on the, you can imagine like someone developing an AI solution for healthcare. So if people who are using the technology are not engaged well, then they may not even not trust the results from the technology or from the solutions. So to us as a lab, we think we are trying to put a human-centered design at the center and also engaging the participatory approach. Thank you.
Thank you. Also very much a question of trust. Anoop, what can be done? Telegraphic answer, if I may ask you.
That data security policies, which are to the European data policy, and also national level, we can have data security and data protection policy for the end users. So that's why you can build up starts and other aspect of responsible innovation and responsible research in AI and ML. Thank you.
Thank you. Sharik, you have the final word. What can be done?
To be very honest, it's a topic of another discussion. It's a very, you know, it can't be, you know, summarized in one word. But then I would say better research, and better global cooperation and coordination, and positive approach and trust, like you said.
Thank you for that. And I think this cooperation, collaboration, discussion, sharing starts here, what we've been doing today, what we've been doing for the whole week. Thank you all. Thank you to our panelists for bringing in their expertise, experience, and perspectives. Thank you to the participants for attending, but not just attending, but for really participating, for co-creating this space, this workshop. I've been really struck by how much, well, I've learned, obviously, but also by how much collaboration, discussion, eagerness to understand. It's been really apparent that we've been able to create something, to me, very, very special, very, very interesting. Thank you all. I would like to ask Teresa first and then Marco to have a final word of goodbye and closure of the workshop. Teresa?
Just briefly, I would like to thank you for involving me in the organizations and all participants and speakers. I've learned a lot. So I hope and look forward to other meetings like these and have other opportunities to collaborate and keep in touch.
Thank you,
Teresa. Marco?
Yeah. Thank you all. It was a great panel. Thank you, Roberto, for sharing that. And a word of, the issue of, data, local data has been raised in today's panel. And please don't forget that ICTP can help in facilitating, the exchange. So when you're talking from Tanzania and from Nigeria having the same issues, I always think it would be great for people to, collaborate once they meet here at ICTP or, virtually at ICTP. So please continue the discussion and let's see if there's space for collaboration. Thank you very much. And hope to see you in the next activity.
Thank you, Marco, for leading this and ICTP for hosting us. It's been really, really interesting. And I very much hope these connections that we have been starting to make will strengthen, will continue. And so thank you all. This ends the event, ends the workshop. And hopefully we'll have other opportunities to continue this important and really interesting discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
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 Bye-bye.